come and to share just a little bit about the good things God is doing around the world, especially in my part of the world, which is Latin America. It's good to have my good friend with me, Dr. Ken Archer, from a professor of Pentecostal theology at the Southeastern University of the Assemblies of God, but he's the Church of God boy. They just let him teach over there, okay? So, but it's good to be here today and to take this opportunity to share the Word of God with you and to tell you a little bit about what's happening in Latin America. A voice for the hurting and the forgotten. If you think about your own situation, you think about this great state of Florida, who are the most forgotten and the hurting, most hurting people today in this state? I'm sure that you could come up with two or three different groups of people that you think about, but I would just offer two groups of people for you to consider. Number one, the prisoners. Prisoners in this state. We have a judicial system that is inoperable. It's not working. It's not functioning. Amen. In the United States of America today. It does not rehabilitate. It's punitive, but not restorative. So some of the people who are hurting the most in this state, in our nation today, are prisoners. But also in the state of Florida, there's another group of people. We call them immigrants. We call them migrant workers that many times work in situations of duress and abuse, of even sexual harassment in the tomato fields. And I'm here today to tell you that God has a very special love and concern for the people who hurt the most. And this has been the theology. This has been my understanding of Scripture for many, many years. That where the most pain is, where the most oppression is, there is where the church should also be found.
Amen.
But so many times we have abandoned the poor. We have abandoned the hurting. And we have gravitated to the rich and the powerful and the famous, when our hearts and the heart of God is there among the people we call the little people of the earth. Not because they are less significant, but because Jesus talked about the least of these, my brethren. And when we look in the pages of Holy Scripture, we can start out in Genesis and we can work our way all the way through to Revelation. And I would dare say to you this afternoon that in most churches, in many places in the United States of America, the Bible we read has a huge hole in it.
Yes.
Did you hear me?
Yes, sir.
The gospel that we proclaim has a huge hole in it. We pride ourselves on being a full gospel church, but so many times the gospel that we preach is a partial gospel. When I read Scripture, when I look at God's heart for people, I must take into consideration what God says all throughout Scripture, in a variety of places, in a variety of ways, all the way back to the law and the prophets, all the way back to the wisdom literature of Israel. And we find such great passages and such great calls to justice and solidarity with the poor. Throughout Scripture, we read great Psalms, we read great Proverbs. Do we ever stop to think For example, that in Psalm chapter 147, Psalm 147, the scripture says, "Blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, the maker of heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them, the Lord who remains faithful forever, who upholds the cause of the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry, who sets the prisoners free, the Lord who gives sight to the blind, the Lord who lifts up those who are bowed down, the Lord who watches and loves, watches over the righteous, the Lord who watches over the alien, sustaining the fatherless and the widow. But he frustrates, the Bible says, the ways of the wicked." That's the word of God, my friends. That's the word of God for us today. And as we make our way all through the pages of Holy Writ, we find many, many passages. We don't even have time today to give justice to the way God himself talks about the special love and the special concern that he has for the poor, for the little people. We go to the Proverbs, for example. You go to Proverbs 31, the famous proverb that we use sometimes to talk about the virtuous woman and all the things that women are supposed to do when they're wonderful women and wives and mothers. But did you know there in the verse 8 of that very same chapter of Proverbs, it says, "Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves."
That's what it says.
Amen. "And for the rights of all who are destitute." Mm-hmm. Speak up for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy. This is the word of God. If we go just a little bit further, we really get into the thick of things. We really get into the heart of the matter when we start looking at God's revelation to the prophets, and how the prophets were to speak out against injustice, how they were to speak out in favor of those who were in need. Is this the Bible that you have never read? Have you read this Bible? Have you read the scripture? It took me many years to discover this part of the scripture. I grew up in a little middle class white church down in Monroe, Louisiana. And when I went to Latin America 36 years ago as a missionary, I had no idea of what I was getting into. But through the years, God has been faithful, and God has helped me in my understanding of Scripture. And I have discovered all throughout the Bible, again and again, and again, this call that comes from God to stand up for those who are in need. If we go to just the prophet Isaiah, if we look at what he has to say, for example, there are many examples, but if we just look at one or two examples, we would go to Isaiah chapter 58, and we find there very clearly describe what God requires of us, those of us who consider ourselves spiritual, those of us who consider ourselves to be somehow holier than other people. The Bible says that the prophet tells the people how they are to fast. We full gospel, Pentecostal folks, we talk about fasting and prayer and all these great spiritual disciplines. And yes, they're wonderful and they're necessary. The question is not whether we pray or fast. The question is, how do we pray? How do we fast? Why do we do these things? And the Bible is very clear. God says to his people, and he would say to us today, verse 6, chapter 58, he said, "Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen. It is to loose the chains of injustice and to untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free, to break every yoke. Is it not to share your food with the hungry, to provide the poor wanderer with shelter? When you see the naked, to clothe him, and do not turn away from your own flesh and blood. Then your light, the Bible says, then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Might I suggest this afternoon that perhaps why the reason some of us are not healed, we're not following the biblical injunction. We're not following the biblical pattern, because the Bible says here that when you do these things, then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear.
Amen.
There is a relationship between healing and social justice, according to this scripture. We could go on and go through the prophets, and I could stop in just about every prophet, both major and minor, and show passages and talk to you about the ways that God requires his people to reach out and to help those who are in need. Could this be the Bible that we never read? Could this be the gospel with a hole in it? And Amos is considered to be a great champion, a prophet of social justice. And Amos, we find these words: you trample on the poor and force him to give you grain. Therefore, though you have built stone mansions, you will not live in them. Though you have planted lush vineyards, you will not drink their wine. For I know how many are your offenses and how great your sins. You oppress the righteous and take bribes, and you deprive the poor of justice in the courts. Therefore, the prudent man keeps quiet in such times, for the times are evil. But he goes on to say, seek good and not evil, that you may live. Then the Lord God Almighty will be with you, just as you say he is. Hate evil, love good, maintain justice in the courts. Perhaps the Lord God Almighty will have mercy on the remnant of Joseph. Then over just a few verses later, he says, away with the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the music of your harps, but let justice roll down like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream. This is the word of God, my brothers and sisters. These are not the words of any political candidate. I wish they were the words of some of our political candidates. I wish our presidential candidates were talking more about justice. Amen. And about poverty and about the way we are to treat one another, then we might have some decent choices. Sorry, just throw a little bit of commentary in here.
It's all right.
We move on through the Old Testament. We get down to one of the last prophets there, Micah. I have a grandson by the name of Micah. And my prayer for my Micah is that perhaps one day he would speak up in the spirit of this Micah. Because this Micah comes to echo and to repeat in a very similar pattern, the same concern that God has for justice. Micah chapter 6, verse 6 says, with what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? Then he comes back with the answer. He has showed you. He has showed you, oh man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you. Three things: to act justly, or in other words, to do justice, to love goodness and mercy, and to walk humbly with your God.
Amen.
To do justice, to love mercy. I don't know about you, but I need lots of mercy. I need lots of mercy. I need lots of second chances in my life. And God has been merciful to me. So we need to show justice. We need to show mercy. We need to show kindness. We need to show goodness. And we need to walk in humility before God. In humility before God. So everything we've said so far this afternoon comes straight out of the pages of the Old Testament. We don't even have to go to the New Testament to see God's heart for justice, to see God's heart for the poor. But that just opens up the door. It just opens up the book for us to move into the New Testament. Now, we're not going to try to exhaust what the New Testament says, because we would be here for a few weeks probably. And I could come here to give you a lecture or a class or a course. You can go to Southeastern University and take class with Dr. Ken Archer, and he'll fill in all the blanks and answer all the questions that you have about these issues. Okay? But even as we move out of the Old Testament into the New Covenant, what do we find? We find the very same God of the Old Testament who becomes incarnate, who comes to live with us. He pitches his tent among us. Or as one man said, he moved into the neighborhood. Aren't you thankful that God moved into your neighborhood?
Amen.
Aren't you thankful that God knows everything you feel, every temptation, every problem, every situation, every addiction? Jesus Christ has conquered death, pain, suffering, sickness. And we can follow in his footsteps. And we can live a victorious life. Perfect only in Jesus, yes. Complete in Jesus. But in this life, yes, we struggle. We work. We struggle mightily against sin in this life. We do not lay down before it. We struggle against it. And when we sin, we repent. We ask for God's mercy and strength to go another day and another mile. So when Jesus comes, he takes on the form of human flesh, and he himself stands up in the synagogue in Nazareth on the Sabbath day, and he takes his text, he takes his scripture reading from the prophet. I've been talking to you about the prophets. Well, Jesus, he walks into the synagogue, and the guy who's in charge hands the scroll to Jesus, and he opens it up, and he finds the scripture, and he begins to read from Isaiah chapter 61. Jesus, the prophet, the great teacher, our Savior, our healer, our sanctifier. He was a prophet. And he began to read. He said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor." That's St. Luke's Gospel chapter 4, Verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight to the blind, to release the oppressed, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, the Jubilee year of the Lord. Going all the way back to Leviticus chapter 25, when all the slaves were set free, when all of the land was returned to the original owners of the land. If we were to practice Jubilee today, we would give all the land back to the original owners of this country, the Indians. If we were to practice Jubilee today, a lot of things would be different about this country. You see? But this is exactly the challenge that Jesus gives to us in his church. Even if we don't see it practiced in our country, we must strive to practice it in our churches, in our relationships with one another. So Jesus is the prophet who comes preaching the year of God's favor, the Jubilee year, God's special concern for the little people. Jesus was a man from the marginal region of Galilee, which belonged to the marginal region of Palestine, which was on the outskirts of the Roman Empire of the time. But from the margins of society, from the fringes of society, God speaks. And he speaks today. He still speaks today from the fringes of society. And so Jesus, he has this uncanny ability. He has this liberating mission. He always reaches out to the children, to the battered women, to the sick, the abused, the lepers, the prisoners. Jesus is a man of the people. He's a man who's concerned about justice, about the little people. In fact, he goes as far as to say in Matthew chapter 25 that one of the major criteria of inheriting eternal life is how you have treated the least of these my brethren. Does he not? So being saved is not just a matter of raising your hand and saying the sinner's prayer, as important as that may be at a particular moment in time. The Bible says here, chapter 25, he said, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heaven, and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd. Shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and he will put the sheep on the right and the goats on the left. And then the king will say to those on his right, come you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. Why? For I was hungry. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothing, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. And the righteous will be, they'll be surprised, and they're going to ask each other, they're going to say, When did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothed and clothed you? Or when did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? And the king will reply, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it for me.
Amen.
This is the Bible, my friends. This is the inspired, holy Word of God. We could go on and on. We could look at case after case. We can look at Jesus' special treatment of the Samaritan woman. We can look at the way that Jesus lifted up the Samaritan, the Good Samaritan, as an example of neighborly love. We can look at that first community of Christians after on the day of Pentecost, as they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and as a result of this Spirit, life shared their possessions. You think I'm making this up? It's right here in the book. Right here in the book. Let me just close this afternoon just by going to one of the letters of the letter of the Apostle James. It's not just the prophets of the Old Testament, it's not just the law of the Old Testament, or the Psalms of the Old Testament, not just in the teaching of Jesus, not just in the early church on the day of Pentecost, but throughout Scripture and throughout history, we find these kinds of concerns. The Apostle James, he says here in the second chapter, verse 14, he says, "What good is it, my brothers, if a man claims to have faith but has no deeds? Can such a faith save him? Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food, and one of you says to him, 'Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed,' but does nothing about his physical needs. What good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead." Amen. Faith without works is dead.
Amen.
In that chapter 1, verse 27, he said, "The kind of religion that God, our Father, accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world." So my friends, this afternoon, I come here just to share this scripture with you and to let you know that all across Latin America today, from Mexico, Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador, Belize, Honduras, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama, Colombia, Venezuela, Ecuador, where I live, Peru, Bolivia, Chile, Argentina, Paraguay, Uruguay, and all across the Mediterranean, even in Cuba, Puerto Rico, Dominican Republic, the Church of God is rising up. The Church of God is rising up to respond to this demand for justice. The Church of God is rising up to be the hands and feet of Jesus. And in the country of Honduras, on that very small little country in Central America, today I can report to you that over 5,000 children are being fed every week in Church of God congregations. I don't mean spiritually fed. They are being spiritually fed. But I'm talking about food that you take off of the fork and you put it in your mouth. I'm talking about children that come out of the slums. I'm talking about children that live in situations where there are gangs and violence and drug lords. But the Church of God is opening their temples. They're opening their buildings for these children to come in, to be taught, to read the Word of God, to sing praises unto the Lord. I can report to you today that just in the one little country of Honduras alone, there are two hospitals. Yes. Full-fledged, full hospitals sponsored by the Church of God.
Amen.
And over 20 clinics around the country of Honduras. I can report to you today that all across Latin America, There are 14 orphanages fully functioning. My wife and I were the pioneers of this movement. In 1986, we started the very first home for children in Latin America. And now we've seen this ministry multiply and grow and expand. We have real rehabilitation centers in Colombia and Panama for drug addicts. We have shelters and ministry for battered women across the region. The Church of God is waking up to her social responsibility. We preach the gospel through word, through sign, and in deed. The word of God goes forth through what we say, but it must go further than that. You've heard the saying, one picture is worth a thousand words. Okay? Words are important, yes. What we say matters, yes. But let me tell you, as the apostle said, faith without works is dead, and our speech, our words without action is to no avail. So the word of God must be preached by all means. Through word, through sign, miracle, miraculous, portent, and through deed. Concrete deeds of human solidarity with those who suffered in ways that are tangible and that people can look to us and say, here I see the hand of God. And I want to invite you this afternoon. I know that this is a church. What I've read, what I've heard about it, what I know of your pastor, I know that you are a church with a heart for the marginalized, for people who are in need. And I'm thinking, what better partnership can we have for a missionary like me? I have a heart for the poor. I have a heart for the marginalized. We have two adopted daughters. We have two sons. We have six grandchildren. Such a wonderful opportunity to join hands and become partners in the work of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Right here in St. Cloud, Florida.
Yes, sir.
And all the way through Central and South America. To Quito, Ecuador.
Amen.
I think that's a good place to stop right there. When you got the people with you, that's a good, pretty good place to stop right there. If they applaud, that might be a pretty good place to end me right now. And we're going to commit all of this to the Lord and ask Him to bless our relationship and our partnership as we move from this point forward. I look for the time, hopefully, in God's timing, when we might see some of you in Latin America, in Quito, Ecuador, come to visit. Or the next time I'm up here, I can come by and give you a praise report about what God's doing. But thank you so much for your attention, and I want to end with this prayer for you today. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, our healer, our Lord, our liberator. We thank you today that your word is complete. The gospel is complete. The gospel is full. The life that we have in you is complete life, full life, for now and eternity. I thank you for this band of believers gathered together today. Lord, you know the situation of every heart, of every life, of every family. The background, the trauma, and the pain that we all experience in this life. But our faith and our trust and our hope is in you. Now, Lord, I pray that you would bind us together. Join us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bless the labor and the work of the hands of Pastor Ian. his wife, his family, all the people of this church. I pray for your prosperity and your blessing that will flow in this church and through this church to many other people. Thank you, Lord, that you are the God of justice. You are the God of life. You are the God of hope. You are the God of salvation. And in you, we will rejoice. And let the people of God say amen.
Amen. Amen.